All right. Well, welcome to this webinar presented by the College Music Society. I'm Hannah Pearson, Director of Operations of CMS, and I'm joined here by my colleague, Bree Buck. It's my pleasure to open our presentation of the CMS Committee on Musicians' Health. Today's discussion will feature Dr. Dan Benardot. Dr. Benardot received his PhD in Human Services Studies and Human Nutrition from Cornell University and is currently Professor Emeritus of Nutrition at Georgia State University and Professor of Practice at Emory University. He is a registered dietitian and a fellow of the American College of Sports Medicine. His research has focused on nutrition for athletic performance, and he is the author of several books on the topic. He is also the author, co-author of numerous research articles focusing primarily on issues related to within-day energy balance and has served as nutritionist for several US Olympic teams. As a cellist, he has had an interest in creating science-based nutrition information for performing artists, and toward that end, created a new course at Emory University entitled Nutrition for Performing Artists, and recently published a journal article entitled Nutritional Concerns for the Artistic Athlete. Before we begin the session, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge that as we gather in the digital space as a society committed to leading positive change, we sit on lands that are historically tied to Indigenous peoples from across the United States. These include the Crow, Northern Cheyenne, Sioux, Gros Ventre, Chippewa, Cree, Blackfeet, Salish, and Little Shell Chippewa, whose lands are the site of CMS's home office in Missoula. We acknowledge the harm that this country, a settler colonialist nation, caused by systemically and forcibly removing Indigenous peoples from their land. As a society striving to shape a profession and our organization is one that is decisively anti-racist, we acknowledge the harms of slavery, white supremacy, and systemic racism tied to our organization's history and to the institutions where we conduct our work. We acknowledge that acknowledgement is not in and of itself enough. Native people still live here. Black and brown people still live here. We pay our respects to the BIPOC people who, in the face of great harm, continue to make contributions to our institutions and our profession as we strive to lead change that results in more equitable futures while engaging with our exquisite, resilient histories.
Thank you, Hannah. I see we have a number of colleagues registered for this webinar from all over the US, Canada, and abroad. We are also recording this webinar for later viewing via the College Music Society's online archives. Before we turn this over to today's presenter, I would like to ask listeners to please stay muted throughout the presentation unless you are part of the conversation. And now it's my pleasure to pass this session on to Dr. Benardot. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm going to share my screen so we can get started with... Hope you can all see that. Okay, very good. So I put together a slide set of some just basic nutritional myths and tried to give you the realities behind these myths. And then at the end of this slide set, then I'd be very happy to take your questions if you have any. So let's get started with the slide set. One issue that we see a lot is that people are looking at weight as a good indicator of health and well-being. But actually, when you consider it, weight is the wrong measure for just about everything that it's commonly used for. It really is not about weight per se. It's about fat mass versus fat-free or lean mass. And if you just stand on a scale, you have no idea if the change in weight that is occurring is coming from fat mass or lean mass. And so we have to be very careful, because we have to be very cautious that the strategy which is being followed doesn't do anything to lower metabolic mass, lean mass. And we have to stop doing things that increase fat mass. And far too often, the nutritional strategies that people take will initially lower weight, but what is being lowered is an excess amount of lean tissue rather than fat tissue. And the result is that now they can't burn calories as efficiently as they could before. And so it's inevitable that after a while, they'll get a rebound of weight increase. So it's kind of scary. And also the terminologies which are used are not good terminologies. I mean, the term obesity and overweight are used interchangeably. They're not interchangeable. Obesity means having too much body fat by definition. Overweight means weighing more than the standard weight to height ratio or body mass index. If you look at this, the picture of this athlete, they would come out as being obese on a standard BMI scale because they're holding so much lean tissue for their height. They're not obese. They're not carrying too much fat. They're not unhealthy. So we have to be very cautious about this. We have to remember that weight change can be derived from different tissues. So it's nice to have more lean mass. It's nice to have more bone mass. It's not good typically to have more fat mass. And it's not bad typically to have more body water because lean mass, if it's healthy, has about 60% water in it. So we have to be very cautious. If you're just looking at weight, you're going to be misled about what actually has happened and whether or not that dietary strategy that has been followed works, right? Really works to your benefit. The other thing we have to be careful about, another thing is that the energy cost of exercise, people think, is always the same. It's very different, you know? So energy is precious for human beings. So I want you to imagine the picture of this person here. If this person started lifting weights, initially, it would be very difficult for them if they had that repeated activity over and over again. Their heart rate would be elevated. They would be burning a huge amount of calories. But because the body treats energy as precious, it's very, very important to imagine something that most people don't imagine. The adaptation that they get is to increase muscle mass by lifting that weight so that they don't burn as many calories. That is, they become more efficient in doing it. So you exercise more, and we eventually find a way to burn less energy to do this exercise because we become more energy efficient. And that's a very important thing, I think, to remember. It's all kinds of studies to show that what I just mentioned is true. We find a way to use less energy doing the same activity. And when you calculate energy utilization via standard means, mass times distance, heart rate, et cetera, it can be misleading. It can be very, very misleading because if you have more musculature to do what you're doing, you probably are burning less calories than you think you are. So you got to be a little cautious about that. Another misperception is that only eating too much will make you fat. Well, guess what? Humans are amazingly effective fat manufacturing machines. You eat too much food, you make fat. You eat too little food, you lose lean mass, and you make fat. It's a survival mechanism that we have. We're carrying genes from hundreds and thousands of years ago where food was not easily available. So it's just something that we have to consider. Here's an example of energy balance. Okay, this is the same person eating three different ways. So perfect energy balance is this zero line that you see. Okay, so what that means is, let's say this is noon where I have the asterisk right now at noon. That means if it's on the zero, that means that the person has eaten exactly the same amount of calories that they have expended. So they're in perfect energy balance. Nobody's in perfect energy balance all day long. You have variations around it. So, you know, you eat a little something, you work it off. You eat a little something, you work it off. And this eating pattern number one, the person is eating six times. And you can see that the deviation from perfect energy balance is not that big. Now, here's the same person who's eating three times. Well, if they only have three times to satisfy the energy that they require, then it's obvious that they have to eat more each time they eat, right? So you see bigger energy balance surpluses here. In simple terms, that means that they're overfilling the gas tank and they're very likely to make more fat as a result of that eating pattern. This is another thing that we've seen a lot of people who exercise. They have a little snack, another little snack. they exercise, they go into a big energy balance deficit. And at the end of the day, they have a big dinner. What's kind of interesting about this, I think, is that the deviation from perfect energy balance has a lot to do with how much fat you carry around and what happens to your lean mass. The bigger the deviation, whether it's too high or too low, can negatively impact what happens, even if at the end of the day, the person has eaten exactly what they need to eat theoretically to support their body. I mean, what's kind of interesting to me is that people think, you know, about this calorie in, calorie out thing that people keep talking about. If you need 3,000 calories and you eat 3,000 calories by the end of the day, everything is perfect. Good things will happen. No, the body works in real time. So we have to have eating patterns that are dynamically linked to the energy expenditure that we have in order to make sure that you can stay in a reasonably healthy place. And if the deviation is too far away from perfect energy balance, you either store a lot of fat as in eating pattern two, or in eating pattern three, where you both lose muscle, and because you have less metabolic mass with which to burn the calories you're eating, you also gain fat. So eating pattern number one, you're not deviating too far away from perfect energy balance, and really good things happen. We published a study long ago, 23 years ago, where we assessed the United States artistic gymnastics team, rhythmic gymnastics team, the top middle distance runners in the United States, and the top long distance runners in the United States. We didn't tell them how to eat. We just analyzed. We did an hour by hour energy balance analysis. And the group that had the most restrictive intake, because they thought, okay, I want to be thin, right? So they were restricting their intake, had the highest body fat level. That was the rhythmic gymnast. And then the second highest had the second biggest deviation from perfect energy balance. And going into this study, we thought the long distance runners would have the lowest body fat percent. No, you can see that they have a bigger deviation here as a surplus than the middle distance runners. And somehow the middle distance runners figured out how to eat so that they could stay in a reasonably good energy balance state throughout the entire day. And they had the lowest body fat. It was fascinating. And if you look at the ending energy balance, they all came within about 100 calories of their predicted requirement. It's how they ate it that made a difference in their state of health and their body composition. It was fascinating. And then we did a secondary analysis, and we found that if you could stay kind of plus or minus 400 calories from perfect energy balance, really good things happen with your body. You can support your lean mass and you don't get too much fat mass. A lot of people think that low calorie diets are the perfect strategy for weight loss, but they're doomed to fail because the body's reaction to an inadequate caloric intake is perfectly logical from a survival standpoint. It's to lower the tissue that needs calories so that you can survive with inadequate caloric intake. And if you look at this, there's a thing called adaptive thermogenesis, where you can see it takes about 6 months of being on a low-calorie diet where adaptive thermogenesis kicks in. And what that means is that your body has become excessively efficient in burning calories. So if you lower your caloric intake by 30%, when adaptive thermogenesis kicks in, you become maybe 35 or 40% more energy efficient. So now on the reduced caloric intake, you go back up to a higher weight, but what constitutes your weight is more fat and less lean. Because fat mass is less dense than lean mass, you look bigger than you did before, even if at the end you're back to your original weight. And because you look bigger, you go on an even bigger energy restrictive diet, and that causes all kinds of havoc. So it's the kind of weight rebound that a lot of people experience. And when you do that, you get all kinds of kidney risks and cardiovascular risks that are scary. You know, people who skip breakfast. Well, you know, when you sleep, maybe you can sleep for seven and a half hours, keep blood sugar normal if you had a little snack before you went to bed. But if you skip, nobody can go 12 hours. You have dinner at 7 o'clock. You don't have breakfast. you know, so nobody can go 12 hours or that long, keep blood sugar normal. And if you don't keep blood sugar normal, the brain stimulates the production of cortisol, which is a stress hormone. You break down lean mass so that the amino acids that can be converted to sugar are taken from muscle. So you get a breakdown of muscle and organ mass so that the brain can keep functioning. The brain is responsible for your survival. So the brain needs energy, and the primary fuel for it is blood sugar. And so look at this. Subjects who skipped breakfast as adults had significantly higher waist circumferences and body mass indexes. Subjects who skipped breakfast as children and as adults had even higher waist circumferences and body mass indexes and more cardiometabolic risk factors. What that means is you don't adapt to doing the wrong thing, right? If you go with that kind of restrictive intake, you're going to achieve a very severe energy balance deficit, which creates havoc with the system, and you become unhealthy. Another thing, you know, a lot of people are busy, so, you know, they think, okay, I'm going to take supplements. You got to be really careful, because body tissues are not meant to have the entire daily requirement for a nutrient at one time. You overfill the cell, you create all kinds of issues. We have to remember that more than enough is not better than enough. It is important to have enough. But here's a little study that was done where they're tracking, in this particular study, it was 38,772 older women who were taking multivitamin supplements or individual nutrient supplements for a long time. Look at the elevated mortality risk. I mean, everything else was the same. I mean, you know, that randomly selected population, right? Those who were taking it versus those who were not. Look at the higher mortality risk that happens. The only thing that seemed to lower mortality risk when you're taking it as a supplement was calcium, right? Why? Because if you constantly present too much nutrient to a cell, it's a chemical. The cells try to protect themselves from this chemical because they're getting too much. And so they lower the rate of intake. Now this chemical can go banging around the intestines. Classical example is, you know, folic acid. I mean, if you have too much folic, here's the example. The recommended intake for folic acid is 400 micrograms per day. If you have 400 micrograms in a single dose, you increase cancer risk. If you have exactly the same amount in 100 microgram units spread out throughout the entire day, you lower cancer risk, right? So it's because you're providing it in units that the cells can actually use. I think it's a very important thing to consider. We're meant to eat, not meant to take really enormous doses in single doses all at once, right? Another thing that people kind of get in trouble with is that they classify foods as a really good food, a really healthy food, and some foods as a really bad food. Look, there's no perfect food. There is no perfect food. People need to eat a wide variety of foods to be exposed to all of the nutrients that they need. If you think that something like, I've used yogurt here as an example, because a lot of people think, well, yogurt's really good for me, right? Well, yogurt happens to be really low in iron, so, you know, get ready for anemia. But you have to be very cautious about not eating too much of something and not eating too little of something. You have to have different things. When I ask my students, what'd you have for breakfast yesterday? Oatmeal. What'd you have the day before? Oatmeal. What'd you have the day before that? Oatmeal. That's not the kind of a variety that your body actually requires. You need to have different things to make sure that your body can get all of the nutrients that it needs. Also, you're not sure what pesticide was used on that oatmeal, and having it day after day after day may exceed the body's capacity to deal with it. This is an example, different colors, different phytonutrients, right? And you're not gonna see the same phytonutrients in foods of different color. And we need all of these things. We need all of the phytonutrients. You have to have a variety of foods to get everything that you need, right? So if you have a variety, you get better assurance of exposing tissues to all nutrients, and you get better assurance of avoiding excess tissue exposure to any nutrient or substance that's been added to it. So you have to be cautious about eating the same things over and over and over again. I hear this all the time. I'm not going to have anything that has sugar in because it'll make me fat. Okay, if you have too much sugar at once without anything else, yes, you get a hyperinsulinemic response. You load too much energy into the cells. Cells don't know what to do with it. So they make fat, shuttle it out. Your body fat goes up. But the scary thing is, it's not only sugar that causes a hyperinsulinemic response. If you have low blood sugar when you eat, you're automatically hyperinsulinemic. It does not matter what you eat. It could be a perfect meal. You're going to make more insulin than you would have if you ate when your blood sugar was normal. And the other thing that's kind of nasty is that if you have a hyperinsulinemic response, the appetite-stimulating hormone, ghrelin, is not shut off. It's only shut off if you have a normal insulin response. So if you eat when you're really hungry, low blood sugar, you end up eating more than you would have if you ate when blood sugar was normal. It's very important to have smaller amounts with greater frequency than to wait to get really hungry and then you just can't control themselves, right? So you have to be very, very cautious, right? So, you know, you have to be cautious about this, right? Body's reaction to inadequate energy intake is to lower the tissue that needs calories, lean mass, not fat mass. So staying in a good energy balance state ends up being really, really critical, right? So the commonly stated calories in, calories out thing that people keep talking about is nonsense because the endocrine system works in real time, right? So if the 3-meal-a-day pattern that people think is really good has nothing to do with human physiology. It was created by the Industrial Revolution where the industrialists said, have breakfast before you come to work. We'll give you a half an hour break for lunch. And if you want to have dinner when you get home, that's great. That doesn't work because blood sugar goes from normal to too low in 3 hours after you eat. That's if you have normal activity. If your heart rate is elevated, if you're exercising, you don't even have 3 hours. And if you don't keep blood sugar normal, you're going to get a cortisol elevation. You're going to tear down your lean tissue. You will, over time, inevitably end up with a higher body fat than you wish you had because of that reality. So we have to think about energy balance in real time, right? As I mentioned before, the deviation is very important. The traditional 24-hour view of it does not work. We have to consider how the deviations work and, you know, how much time you spend in an energy balance deficit. Too much time in a deficit, blood sugar gets low. The next time you eat, you're going to make too much fat. You're going to break down your muscle mass as a result of the low blood sugar. Bad things happen. If too much time in a surplus, you're going to store the excess energy in as fat. You have to be careful. I mean, I can give you an analogy for this that it may be easier to understand. If you want to drive from New York City to Los Angeles and you have a car you can talk with, all right, you talk to your car and say, oh, look, I really need to get to Los Angeles in a hurry. The gas tank is full. I know it's not enough gas, but take me to Los Angeles. I promise I'll give you all the gas you needed for the trip once we get there. You can't do that with your car. And guess what? You can't do it for yourself either. I mean, the body has survival mechanisms to get by, but the survival mechanisms ultimately are not great for your overall health. So we got to be really careful that we stay in a good energy balance state and we distribute nutrients in a way that the tissues can actually use them throughout the day. Everybody's worried about protein, but nobody knows how to eat it, right? Here's a beautiful study done by Doug Padden-Jones out of Houston, who showed this. This is the way this population was eating. They had a little bit of protein for breakfast. They had a little bit more for lunch. But boy, in the evening, oh my goodness, they really nailed the protein. They had a lot. When you calculated the total protein intake that they were consuming, it was plenty. But this population could not keep their muscle mass or their bone mass up because of the way they were eating the protein. So it's not just having enough protein, it's knowing how to eat it. He decided to make a change. He said, oh, well, let's take the same amount of protein, but even it out so they have 30 grams, 30 grams, 30 grams. Total protein is the same. Guess what happened? All of a sudden, they are able to keep their muscle mass and their bone mass. This was a nursing home population, a nursing home population. So what we have found with everybody is that most people need to have protein intakes that do not exceed 20 to 30 grams, depending on their body size and their musculature, at a single meal. You exceed that, then the protein just gets converted to fat or is converted to carbohydrate, but it's no longer protein. You can't use it anabolically. So it ends up being a rather huge problem. This is an example of a professional football player. These green lines are the energy balance boundaries that that football player had. You can see at the end of the day, at about 7:30, they had an almost a 1,000 calorie energy balance deficit. That is, their body burned 1,000 calories more than they had provided to it. Now, this same football player had a protein intake that far exceeded the recommendation for athletes. The recommendation for non-athletes is 0.8 grams per kilogram per day. For athletes, it's up to 2 grams per kilogram per day. He had 2.57 grams of protein per kilogram. But look, he was eating it, most of it, at the end of the day when they were in a steep energy balance deficit. All of this protein was being used to satisfy the energy requirement. And so it couldn't be used anabolically to build tissue, repair tissue, make hormones, make enzymes, all of the other things that protein can do, because he didn't understand how to eat it. So if you subtract this 95 grams from the person's intake, you realize that they actually had a protein deficit, not because they didn't have enough protein. They had a protein deficit because they didn't know how to eat it, so that they could stay in an anabolic state and keep the protein as protein. This is an energy balance issue. That is, if you can stay in a reasonably good energy balance and at the same time distribute your protein throughout the day as you need it, then good things will happen. If you don't, bad things will happen. I published this article to show that the ending energy balance strategy that most people talk about is a disaster. You have to stay within a reasonably good energy balance state, plus or minus about 400 calories throughout the entire day, so that you can make sure that your body works the way you want it to. And if you distribute your calories that way, hopefully you're eating reasonably good food, so you're distributing your nutrients that way as well. And good things will happen if you make that kind of distribution. Just remember that more than enough is not better than enough, right? And make sure that you understand that providing a little bit over time is far better than providing too much at once, because the body doesn't react to that particularly well. So common nutrition problems, poor knowledge of foods, inadequate cooking skills, poor or outdated knowledge of nutrition, lack of access to dietitians, inadequate finances, busy lifestyle, that sounds like music teachers to me, not enough time to obtain appropriate foods, poor making weight strategies, poor nutritional role models, and the recommended dietary allowances, even though they're listed in 24-hour units, they're not meant for people to have that much nutrient. So the recommended dietary allowance for vitamin C is 60 milligrams. You're not meant to have 60 milligrams at once. You're meant to have maybe 5 or 10 spread out throughout the entire day so that your tissues can use it as they need it. If you have too much at once, you just lose it, right? And that's what happens with a lot of these supplements. So you got to be careful. Poor availability of good foods, indiscriminate use of large amounts of supplements, workplace limitations to doing it right. You have to bring snacks with you. It's very, very important. Some fruit, some good whole grain crackers, something so that you can keep blood sugar normal. And, you know, these eating patterns that we have, three meals a day is terrible. We have to figure out how to resolve that. And worrying more about weight than finding appropriate strategies to deal with body fat. I mean, that's really very important. And thinking that hydration is something to recover from. So a lot of people drink when they get thirsty. Well, thirst is an emergency sensation. You've already lost a liter and a half of water for thirst to kick in. It's your brain saying, what in the world are you doing? Why aren't you drinking something? You know, so people need to find ways to avoid thirst. Sip on a beverage, sip on water when you're eating. Make sure you have plenty of water when you eat food and carry a bottle with you so that you always can avoid getting thirsty. A very simple rule is if your urine is dark, that means you're dehydrated. You have to figure out a way to produce relatively clear urine. It's not just healthy, it's also good for your kidneys. They're going to last a lot longer if they don't have to concentrate the components of what they have to get rid of. So very important for that. So I hope that was useful. I'm very happy to take questions.
Thanks so much, Dan. So right now we have just a few minutes for questions. Give folks a minute to pop those into the chat.
Okay. Should I look at the chat? Don't be shy. I'm actually friendly, so you don't have to worry about asking a question.
So I'm not seeing any questions popping up for the moment, but we will have this webinar archived for later viewing. So for those of you who missed,
I have one Q&A.
Looks like we do have a Q&A.
Okay. How do you find the right balance with a busy schedule? It's a very good question. How do you deal with a busy schedule? It's on your calendar, right? Right. So the only way you can deal with it nutritionally is to elevate the importance of nutrition to the same level as your work schedule. So if you can say to yourself, okay, I know I'm going to have breakfast when I wake up. I'm going to have a little snack with me so that I have it mid morning. I'm going to have lunch. I'm going to have a snack with me so that I can have it mid afternoon. People worry, well, if I have all those snacks when I get fat, here's the interesting thing. People who eat more often eat fewer calories than people who eat less often, because ghrelin, the appetite stimulating hormone, is controlled, right? So it's exactly the opposite of, a lot of people are fearful of having a piece of fruit or, you know, some string cheese with it or something. But if you can figure out a way to avoid low blood sugar throughout the day based on the activities that you have, it really works. Have you ever heard of the Mediterranean diet? My guess is that you've heard of it. You know, it's very popular. People talk about how healthy the Mediterranean diet is. And they say it's healthy because you eat less red meat, you eat more fish, eat more fresh fruits, more fresh vegetables, right? You have olive oil, which is mainly oleic fatty acid, which is a monounsaturated fatty acid that the body can deal with very nicely. They say all of these things, but they miss something really important about the Mediterranean diet. And that is, in the Mediterranean basin, they eat 7 or 8 times a day, right? They distribute their food over many meals. You have breakfast, you have a mid-morning snack, you have lunch, you have a mid-afternoon snack, you have the initial first little small appetizer dinner, then you have your regular dinner. Then you have a little something after that, and then you have something before you go to bed. So they never go too long to achieve a low blood sugar. They have lower metabolic risks. They have lower body fat, less cardiovascular problems, fewer kidney problems if you eat in that pattern. So it has to be planned. The only way you can do this is, and people say, well, I'm afraid. Okay, we'll do this. Whatever you have for breakfast, don't eat it all. Take some of it. and eat it mid-morning. Whatever you have for lunch, don't eat it all. Take some of it and eat it mid-afternoon. Whatever you have for dinner, don't eat it all. Take some of it and have it mid-evening, right? And then I hear this thing, well, if I eat anything after 7 o'clock at night, that will make me fat. Are you kidding me? Whoever said that wanted you to be fat, that's so far from the truth. When you look at the science, it's nonsense. Let me ask you this. Would you ever put a baby to bed without feeding them? No. And the reason you wouldn't is because they'd get a cortisol response, stress hormone. They would be very agitated. Not only would they not sleep, you wouldn't sleep. Guess what? Same thing happens to us. You need to have a little snack before you go to bed just to make sure you can maintain a normal blood sugar throughout the entire night. Very important to do. I hope that answered your question. Radina is asking if I have an email. Yes, I have an email at Emory University. It's my name. So it's dan.benardot@emory.edu. If you want me to answer your questions, I get about 500 emails every day because of the books and articles I've written. So make sure you put podcast music teachers in the subject line so I know it's you. Okay. So another question is, I regularly hear lately that you should not drink water simply to drink it, but rather wait until your body signals to do so, thirst. Can you square this with your statement to regularly sip? I've heard the same. You know, these strange things keep coming up, but one of the worst things you can do is to allow blood volume to get too low. So if you get thirsty, that lowers your stroke volume. That means the heart has to work harder to deliver nutrients and oxygen to your cells. That means the kidneys have to concentrate urine, which is damaging to them, to get rid of metabolic byproducts, which are dangerous. The worst thing you can do is get thirsty. So one thing I want you to think about is this: the solution to pollution is dilution, right? So if you can keep a reasonably good blood volume and create a clear urine, good things happen. Now, water should be consumed when you eat foods, okay? At other times, if you're going, like, if you're exercising, because you're using sugar at a much faster rate and you're losing sweat, which contains salt in it, it makes sense to learn how to sip on a sports beverage. But you have to learn how to sip it, because a lot of people wait until they get thirsty. And when they get thirsty, then they'll drink the entire bottle of sports beverage all at once. That's too much at once. So you have to learn how to sip to avoid thirst. So you just learn how to take a couple of sips. I was the nutritionist for the United States Marathon team in Athens in 2004. And that was a lesson we actually had to teach them how to do. We called it a grab and carry technique, where the marathoners get to grab their bottle every 5 kilometers. And what they used to do is take a couple of sips, pour some of it over their head, and throw the bottle away. And what we taught them, no, you got to drink the whole thing. So they grab it, they sip on it, they run with it, they sip on it, they run with it. And then by the time they get to the next 5 kilometer mark, they can take their next bottle. It's very important, because that helps blood, the heart, to not overwork. It delivers oxygen better to tissues. Very good things happen. We won 2 Olympic medals at the same marathon following this and other strategies that I've talked to you about just now. It's the first time in the United States history that we won 2 Olympic medals at the same Olympic Games. And that drinking strategy was very important. So you have to make sure that you never get thirsty, right? Drink plenty of fluid while you eat. And make sure if you're active, you're drinking enough fluid to replace what you're losing. Any other questions? What's the best amount of time in between meals to achieve this balance? I've heard 3 to 4 hours. Normal blood sugar, so you eat, blood sugar reaches its peak about 1 hour after you eat. 2 hours after that, it's back to pre-meal levels if you're just doing normal daily activity. If your heart rate is elevated, if you're physically active, that time gets compressed. So you need to have some source of energy more often than that. That's one of the reasons, actually, for sports beverages, right? Because sports beverages contain a little bit of carbohydrate in it. And that's very important for sustaining blood sugar. The sodium is very important for sustaining blood volume, so you can sustain stroke volume. It ends up being extremely, extremely important to do that. So 4 hours is too long under any circumstance. But, you know, a simple guide. I mean, if you go to the Olympic Training Center, they actually give the athletes a card and it has colors on it for the color of urine. And they say, you know, try to keep your urine at that very light color, because if it's dark, it means you're dehydrated. And if you're dehydrated, that means your heart is working too hard and you're going to get exhausted far too fast if you do that. So the in-between meal time where it says 3 to 4 hours, no, that's too long. So you have to have something to eat at least every 3 hours when you're awake. If you're asleep, you've got 7.5, 8 hours at the most, right? So if you have something just before you go to bed, you sleep for 7 hours, you wake up, and soon after that, you have a, you know, a little something to eat. You don't wait too long to eat, because then you can get low blood sugar, you can get a cortisol response, you can lose lean mass. So it's very important to have that breakfast soon after you wake up so that you don't achieve low blood sugar. So let me see what, I guess that's it for the questions. I don't know. Anyway, I'm very happy to answer your questions if you'd like to send me an email.
Thank you so much, Dan. And thank you everyone for joining us and for taking time out of your Friday to attend the session. And we look forward to seeing you at future CMS webinars.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here.